So today we will start a new chapter, namely applications of homology. Here what we will do, we will give a few popular applications of homology. Some of these results one can prove in different methods also, and some of them you have already seen in part one without using the homology theory. Okay, so having said that, the idea of proving these things is to emphasize how homology theory actually helps in many problem solving in topology, especially in algebraic topology. So we begin with the famous Brouwer's fixed point theorem, and then go on to prove the Lefschetz fixed point theorem, which is an improvement on Brouwer's fixed point theorem. We then prove what are called as Perry-Ball theorem, you know, Jordan-Brouwer separation theorem, Jordan-Brouwer invariance of domain. So these are all very, very popular, and when these things were proved, the algebraic topology became extremely popular because of such results. Okay. So we begin with the lemma, which must be, it has reminiscent of similar things that we have done in part one using the fundamental group. Now we are using the homology group. Okay, let A be a retract of X. Then H star of A will be retract of H star of X. That is, H star of A is a direct summand of H star of X. Okay. When in a topological space, A and X are topological spaces, A is a subspace of X, A is a retract of X, you don't have all that. All that you have is a continuous function from X to A, which is identity on A. Okay, R is the continuous function from X to A. I is the inclusion map. To take I and then follow by R, that is the identity of A. When you pass to the homology, it will give you that H star of A is a retract of H star of A. That means there will be a homomorphism from H star of X to H star of A. What is it? It is nothing but R. You know, R itself induces a homomorphism, and that will have this property. Okay, so R from X to A is a retraction. R star from X star to X star has is retraction because R star composite eta star, which is the inclusion map, is R composite eta star, which is the identity of I star. So that is the meaning of that R star is a retraction. And whenever you have retraction of abelian groups, the subgroup H star of A becomes a direct summand. Okay, this is a general theory for any abelian group. Okay, for any n greater than or equal to 0, Sn is not a retract of the n plus 1. So this is, it sounds like a negative result, but this is a very, very positive result. Okay, remember this was the starting point of our in a simplicial approximation and what is called as Sperner lemma. We had proved this one, Brouwer's fixed point theorem and so on. Okay, so here it comes very easily, no Sperner lemma and so on, but of course we have to use the homology, whatever big thing that we have done. Namely, the simplest thing that we have done was the computation of Hn of Sn and computation of Hn of Dn plus 1. All Hn n not equal to 0 of Dn plus 1 are 0 because this is contractible. Hn of Sn is infinite cyclic. Okay. If Sn is a retract of Dn plus 1, then hn of sn would have been a subgroup of hn of dn plus 1. But hn of dn plus 1 is 0 and this is not 0. So that's the proof. So the functoriality of the homology is strongly used here in this theorem. You see, from R composite I, R composite eta, which is happening in the topology, we have got the corresponding R star composite eta star happening in the group theory, in the homology groups. Okay, next. So, okay, this thing I already told you, I will repeat it. In part one, we have proved the above result in a different way using simplicial approximation and Sperner lemma. We have also seen that the above result is actually equivalent to Brauer 6-point theorem. The present proof is obviously shorter, though it uses big machine of homology. Okay, so we shall not bother about proving Brauer 6-point theorem. Once you have got this one, okay, you know how to show Brauer 6-point theorem, namely, any continuous map from dn plus 1 to dn plus 1 has a fixed point. Okay, so I am not going to discuss this one anymore because that part is done very thoroughly in part 1. So let us directly do the Lefschetz fixed point theorem. As a consequence, we will get a Brauer 6-point theorem also. Therefore, there is no need to again, spend any time on Brauer 6-point theorem separately. So our next generalization is an application. It's a generalization of this result on any compact polyhedron. Dn is a compact polyhedron, so it will be applicable there also. Now we shall have some hypothesis on the map itself. Okay, on the polyhedron, only compactness is the assumption. On the map, we have some assumption. Recall that given an endomorphism of finite type, okay, endomorphism of a finite type graded module C or C dot or C star, whatever, I'm just writing it as C, okay, graded module tau, we define the Lefschetz number L tau as the alternate sum of the traces of each tau n, okay? So I am just recalling this one. Recall that if tau star denotes the homomorphism induced on the homology groups of the chain complex, then L tau is equal to L tau star. This also you have done. Okay, so this Lefschetz number will be used now in this Lefschetz fixed point theorem. For any continuous map F from X to X on a space X that has finitely generated homology group, we now define LF the same thing as L of F star. The well-known Lefschetz fixed point theorem will be the following. Okay, X be a compact polyhedron, which means what? It is a finite CW complex. K, mod K is homeomorphic to X. Okay, or you can say that X can be cut down into pieces of simplexes, so that the whole thing forms a simplicial complex. Okay. So don't worry about the underlying, the compact, the simplicial structure here. Just take the underlying topological space F from X to F. X is a continuous function. Then if LF is not zero, F must have a fixed point. In Brauer's fixed point theorem, there was no assumption on F except that F is continuous. But X was just dn, the closed unit disk. Okay. So here, this X is any arbitrary simplicial complex, mod k, where k is a simply finite simplicial complex. Suppose we have proved this one. Then how do you prove Brauer 6-point theorem? So if X is dn, okay, any map from X to X is homotopic to identity map. This LF is a homotopy invariant because it depends only on the homology groups. Therefore, LF will be equal to L of the identity map. Now, L of the identity map is easy to compute because the only homology group of Dn is H0. And H0 is infinite cyclic. On infinite cyclic, on H0, any map induces identity map. Okay, because connected components go to connect same connected component. There's only one connected component. Okay, therefore, L of any continuous function is equal to 1. Now this says if LF is not 0, there is a fixed point. So that is an easy proof of Brauer's fixed point theorem from this theorem. Okay, so let's go towards the proof of this itself now. So this is what I have said here. I will repeat it. X is, if X is Dn, then F is homotopic to identity map of Dn. Because Dn is contractible, any two functions into Dn are homotopic. Since LF is homotopy invariant, it follows that LF is L of ID, identity map. But identity map is nothing but Euler, L of identity map is nothing but Euler characteristic of the space Dn. Therefore, L of ID is 1 since Dn is contractible. Okay? Thus, the requirement of the theorem is satisfied. So, in conclusion, we can say that F has a fixed point. Okay? So, this shows that Lefschetz fixed point theorem is a generalization of Brauer's fixed point theorem. Indeed, we just have derived a stronger version of Brauer's fixed point theorem, namely, any self map of a compact contractible polyhedron has a fixed point. We never use that it's actually Dn, only contractibility we used. Okay, so this is another intermediary result which follows from Lefschetz fixed point theorem. So let us see some more results also, but before that, let us try to complete the proof of this. Given a compact polyhedron and a continuous self map, suppose it has no fixed points, then we want to show that LF is zero, some such thing, right? We will have to show LF is zero, fine. Now, this being a compact polyhedron, and that is a finite cylindrical complex, we have seen that there is always a linear metric. Okay, you can choose any linear metric and find an epsilon such that distance between x and fx is bigger than this epsilon. Okay, for every x belonging to x. All right. So why this is true? So you have to use some topology here. On a compact metric space, distance between x and x fx is a continuous function. Okay, real valued continuous function, non-negative. So it attains its minimum. And attains its minimum means that minimum will be positive. To take that positive number, epsilon, then everything else will be bigger than that. That's it. Okay. So K be a simple shell complex that triangulates X. Now, I will use a special for some particular chosen something. It arbitrarily chosen, I don't care, but I will fix some triangulation on X. Now, X is nothing but mod K, okay? Now, I can choose, go on subdividing the K as many times as possible, okay? As many times as required so that the mesh of K, which is the, by definition, maximum of the, all the diameters of F, where F reigns over all the simplices, is less than epsilon by 3. You can keep cutting down so that each simplex will be of diameter less than epsilon by 3. Okay? So this is also one of the things that we have done in part 1. all that you have to do is keep taking barycentric subdivision, each time the diameter becomes a fixed constant times, that's when that constant is less than one. So if you repeat it several times, then it will be less than any given number. Okay, so we have got a K which has this property. Now I further subdivide it by barycentric subdivision. So STK, I don't know how many times. So what this STK is, I'm calling it as L, but what it serves is, there is a simplicial approximation to F. F is a continuous function. Okay? But phi is a simplicial approximation to F. All right? Any simplicial approximation is automatically, namely mod phi, is homotopic to F. Therefore, L of mod phi is the same thing as L of F. You want to show that L of F is 0, we can show that L of mod F is 0. Okay? So that is what we are trying to do now. Now, how do we use this information, all this information? Why all this was done then? So the first thing we claim is the following. Take rho to be any simplex of L, namely this SD of K. Let sigma belonging to K be such that rho is contained inside sigma. Because rho is a subdivision, all simplexes in the subdivision are contained inside a larger one. They are part of a larger simplex which have been divided, right? Divided, and so on. So each rho is contained in some sigma. Whenever this relation happens, what we say is, look at phi of sigma, see your phi of rho. Phi is a simplicial approximation to F. Phi rho intersection sigma will be empty. That means rho was inside sigma. Now because F has no fixed points, this entire rho has gone away, far away. The entire rho of sigma is outside mod sigma. So this is a strong result that we want to prove now. Okay. So that is because of the choice of this epsilon that we have chosen. And then subdivision. The mesh of K is less than epsilon by 3. Okay. So let us see why. Suppose this is not true. That would mean that there is a in the intersection there is a point. So take X belonging to mod rho, I mean underlying space of rho, such that phi x belongs to mod sigma. So there is such an x. Okay. Then both x and phi x will belong to mod sigma because phi rho is inside, rho is already inside, since rho is already inside sigma. So x and both phi x will be inside this mod sigma. Now mod sigma has diameter less than epsilon by 3. Therefore, distance between x and mod phi x will be less than epsilon by 3. On the other hand, if you compute distance between phi x and fx, see what is phi x and fx? Phi is a simplicial approximation to fx. So wherever fx is, phi x will be in the same simplex. And the whole diameter is less than epsilon by 3. Therefore, this is less than epsilon by 3. Okay, you can put equality if you like, less than epsilon by 3. And hence, distance between x and fx will be less than epsilon by 3, which is equal to 2 epsilon by 3 is less than epsilon, now, which that's a contradiction. Because no point has this property that x and fx are less than epsilon because of this property. Okay, x is bigger than epsilon. Therefore, this property 30, this holds. Every simplex of ST of K under phi is thrown off the mother simplex, which contains it in K. All right, now we can use this one. The only problem is that when you divide, subdivide, the chain complexes are different, right? The chain complex of the simplicial chain complex of the subdivision, and simplicial chain complex of original thing, they are different. When you have different chain complexes, though you have a map, there is no trace defined. The trace is defined only for an endomorphism of the same module to itself. An endomorphism, not a homomorphism. Right? So that is the difficulty here, and it has to be overcome somehow. And there are different methods of doing that. So I'll give you two methods here, which I like. Some other methods I don't like, and I even doubt them. So first method, I use the CW chain complex associated with the simplicial complex. Take CK, it can be thought of as a CW chain complex. Okay, so that's what I do. So what I do is, since phi is a simplicial map, it is a cellular map also, right? So it follows that mod phi is a cellular map of the CW complex K. You see, phi is a map from L to K, but mod phi is a map from mod K to mod K, and we have a CW structure there, okay? And in that CW structure, mod phi is a cellular map. Any a cell of K dimension will go inside K dimension cell only, because it is more given by a simplicial map there. Okay, so therefore, let us look at alpha n from Hn of Kn relative to Kn minus 1 to Hn of Kn relative to Kn minus 1. So I have same things here. These are what? These are the chain modules for the chain complex, CW chain complex. Okay. B, the homomorphism induced by mod phi. Restricted to each n, you have this one. I'm denoting them by alpha n. If tau belongs to K, it's a generator. That is the meaning of oriented n simplex. Okay. It's generator here. It follows from this property, okay, that if you take, you know, follow from this property that mod phi of tau intersection tau is empty, right? Tau, what is tau is beyond K is one oriented simplex, okay? In K, it follows that mod phi tau, mod phi tau, what is tau? Tau has been divided into several complexes, several subcomplexes consisting of, say, rho. Each rho is thrown out of tau. So the sum of all of them will be thrown out of tau. So mod phi tau intersection tau is empty. Okay? So I am using this mod tau is a union of all rho here. This is rho, this is sub of that. All tau, take all rho which are contained in tau, so that will form the union of your entire tau. So it will happen that mod phi tau, this is a topological, this is a continuous function, mod phi tau makes sense. Intersection tau mod tau is empty. These two are the subspaces of mod K. Okay, it's empty. But this will mean that when you come to when you come here in this module, okay, what happens is alpha tau n, alpha n of tau, maybe in the combination of some simplices here, but it will never have anything to do with tau. So if you when express alpha n of tau as a linear combination of some ni, say some sigma i's and so on, the ni's will be zero for for this tau. The coefficient of anaerobic this tau will be zero because this is never inverse. It has completely disjoint from this one. Okay, it follows that if you write down the matrix for this one using the basis here, namely tau 1, tau 2, tau n, and so on, the diagonal entries will be all zero. That means the trace of alpha n is zero. But if this is true for n, it is true for all n, right? Therefore, the sum total of all the alternating sums of traces will be also zero. And that is L of mod phi is zero. And that's what we wanted to prove. Okay. The second method is slightly more elaborate, but it teaches you something about the subdivision chain map also. So how to use subdivision chain map? Okay. This property, whatever we have, that will be used here also. This property will be used here also. That is common to it. So here, take the subdivision chain map which you have defined from C dot K to C dot of SD of K. SD is now, little SD is the barycentric subdivision itself, one at a time. Okay. We have seen that this SD induces identity homo isomorphism. That is a beauty. When you go to, forget about this thing, go to H, okay? H of H star of mod K to H star of mod K is identity. By repeated application of this, take compositions from ST of K, SD, SD, SD. That will be a map from C dot of SD of K, okay, sorry, C dot of K into C dot of SD raised to K times K. Okay? Right? So that is our SD. But mod phi is the other way around. Mod phi is from SD of K, CK, C star of SD of K to back to K. So I can compose it back, namely SD of K composite phi. Okay, this is an endomorphism of now of SD of K, C star of SD of K. Okay. Yeah. And this is an when you pass to homology, this part is identity isomorphism because it's composite of identity isomorphisms. Therefore, this LF, which we know equal to L of mod phi, the same thing is L of this composition. After this composition, you are now in the same module to module and endomorphism. Therefore, you can compute a left chain number of this STK composite phi from ST of K to SD of K. Okay. If you pass to homology, it is same thing as homology of mod K. Okay, but we want to compute somehow. So you can do it at this level, at the chain level. So C dot of SD of K with basis elements, complexity of simplicity of SD of K. Now, the property 30 here, okay, will tell you that if you write the expression for this function, when you pass to the at the chain level, okay, it will never involve rho at all. Okay, phi star of rho will not consist of the coefficient of rho will be zero in the phi star of rho. That argument is the same as in this case. Okay, so that is what we have to use. Okay, so let lambda from Cn of SD of K to Cn of SD of K be the chain map induced by SD of K composite phi. Okay, instead of putting a star here and I have put a lambda here. From this property 30, it follows that for any simplex rho, okay, lambda rho will not involve rho at all. Okay, in the expression of lambda rho, a summation of sigma I, ni sigma I, etc. Okay, that coefficient of rho itself will be zero. Okay, in lambda rho, the term rho does not occur at all. Hence, the matrix of lambda rho will have all diagonal entries zero. So the trace is zero. So for each lambda from Cn to Cn, its trace is zero. Alternate sum of these traces will be also zero. So I think I will stop here, and we shall see some interesting applications of the Lefschetz-Fuchs theorem itself next time. Thank you.